Alright, let's get started. I've already loaded in my fire element. This is from Video Copilot's Action Essentials. You can probably find something similar to this on YouTube. There are some channels dedicated to stock footage. If you can't find anything though, I do recommend checking out Video Copilot's Action Essentials. It's a really good element library. But this is what we're going to be using to drive our effect today. Okay, so we need to make a new composition, so click on the new composition button. I'm just going to call this main. 1920 by 1080. We got 30 frames a second, 300 frames, and then click OK. Now, we can notice here the frame rate of this fire element is actually at 23.976, but our composition is at 30 frames a second. So in order for this to work properly, we really want this fire element to be 30 frames a second too. Otherwise, what we're going to have, if we have a composition playing at a faster frame rate than the element is going to hold keyframes in order to match the composition. But this is going to cause certain frames to be held, which means that if you step through this frame at a time, you're going to get certain frames at which the fire isn't moving at all, which is not what we want. So let's go to interpret footage, main, and then type in 30. Okay, so in our composition, let's make a new solid. Call this element text. Click OK. And on this, we're going to add an element effect. And then we're going to make a new text layer. Type in Inferno, enter. And then in order to center this, it's the Control-Alt-Home buttons to center the anchor point. And then to center the entire text, it's Control-Home. You don't have to do this, but I do prefer to look at this centered. And when you're picking a font, make sure you pick a font that all the letters are even on the bottom. Otherwise, certain parts of the letters are gonna go through the ground, which is not something that we want. Okay, we can turn this text layer off, go into element text, go to our custom layers, go to custom text and masks, and then turn on path layer 1 for Inferno. It's going to be our text. Go to scene setup and then extrude. Okay, so I do recommend that you spend a little bit of time here making your text look nice. It's going to be harder to change later since we're going to be copying this scene multiple times. Okay, so I'm going to pull this up a little bit, and I'm going to make a ground plane as well. So click the R key, pull this ground plane up. You can also go down to your transform and just do like 2000% or something like that. We do want quite a big plane. And then zoom in here, pull this down. Okay, so have that resting on the ground, and then just spend a little bit of time making your bevels how you want them to look. I'm actually going to extrude this just a little bit. Give it a little bit more depth, okay? And the next thing, I'm just going to increase the size of my bevel. I'm going to increase that to 1. And then if you wanted to have a more chamfered edge, you can play around with your bevel curve, but that's fine. Okay, the reason you do want to change this now, though, is it will be more complicated to change later, and it will become evident in a moment, okay? All right, let's click OK. So now we need to make a new camera. So let's new camera, and I'm actually going to call this main camera. And then it's the C key, or the unified camera tool up here. And we're just going to middle mouse click and drag this up. Okay. Then we're going to make another camera. It's going to be our secondary camera. And the secondary camera is to get a different angle. So when we're positioning stuff in 3D, it helps to have another view. And in order to have both views at the same time, if we change this to 2 views, middle mouse click over here, and then change this to main camera, and this is our secondary camera. So we can position things in 3D space here, while we can still see the main camera here. Okay. So now we can grab our big fire element, and I'm just going to put this on top of our effect here, our element text. Okay, so the first issue is this is not in 3D yet, it's just following the camera. So we need to click on the 3D button here, the 3D layer button. If you don't see your switches, just right click up here, make sure switches and modes is selected, otherwise you have a button to switch back. I prefer to have mine on one line, so click on that, and there you go, it solves that problem. And then we can click on the position, so click P, and you move the depth so it's behind the text. And then we can pull this up. Move this around. Now, here's one of the interesting things with After Effects. Now, in After Effects, this is not really how any 3D software should really work. In something like Maya, for instance, you're never going to have something that's physically further back and behind another object, yet it's showing up on top of another object. That doesn't really make sense. But since After Effects also uses layers, you can kind of do that, which is sometimes useful, but I think more often than not, this is a little bit counterintuitive. But just remember that the depth can be wherever you want, but then you can change its position in your layer stack. So for instance, this is above element text, so it's going to be above this one, yet really it is behind it in 3D space. So kind of a little bit convoluted. We do actually want this to be behind the text, but here's the problem. So if I pull this behind the text, looks okay, until you notice, well, actually no, it's missed off some of the background. And then if we rotate this around, we can see, oh, okay, well, since this element scene has a ground plane in it, that entire scene is covering this fire. So we're gonna fix that, and I think the method I show you is the best way to do it. I'm sure there is another way to do it as well, but I'm gonna show you my method. All right, so the first thing we need to do is go to the element text, and we're going to duplicate this, a Control D. All right, so on the second one, we're gonna call this ground, and the other one is just going to be, I can just leave that as element text. Okay, so for this next part, I want to show you something. Don't follow along because it's going to end up being incorrect, but I just wanted to show you just so it makes a little bit more sense. So one logical way of thinking would be, all right, so on my ground element, I can go to my scene setup, and on the ground one, I can simply delete the text and click OK. And then on my element text, I can go into the scene setup and then just delete the ground, and everything would be fine. And this might work for you, so then I can definitely put my fire in between these two, which is what we want to do. But here's the problem. When I go to my ground, and let me just reposition this, get this a little bit closer. I'm trying to solo these two. Okay, when I go to the ground, and then I go to render settings, and then go down to shadows, enable shadows, we're going to need that. But let's do ambient occlusion. So enable ambient occlusion, and we usually do ray traced, but notice there is no ambient occlusion. And the reason is, inside this scene, there's only the ground. So After Effects doesn't know that there's supposed to be text here, because there is no text here. So there's nothing for ambient occlusion to use. Okay, nothing is occluding anything, right? So this is the bad way to do it, because you're not going to get those soft shadows or any interaction between those two objects. Okay, so that's kind of a problem. So let me just back out of this and Control Z this a few times until I get back to where I was before. Okay. So in my ground, let's just check, make sure that is still there. Okay, so we're going to do something similar. So on our element text, we can go into the scene setup and we can in fact delete the plane. That is fine. Click OK. Then on the ground one, we need to go to our scene setup. And instead of deleting this text, let's on our extrusion model, and I'm going to double click on this and type in text, and then on this one, ground, just so it's easier to remember which one is which. And then on the text one, click on the material, and if you have multiple bevels, you'll have to do this on each bevel. Let's go to presets, and then physical, and then matte shadow. Okay, so matte shadow, what that is going to do is going to make this transparent, and it's going to allow this object to still be here, and it still is geometry, so ambient occlusion will still work, but it's completely transparent. So the alpha is just being cut out by these letters. Okay, let's click OK. Let me solo this, and now you can see if I toggle my transparency grid, it's transparent, and this one is going to be transparent too. Okay, this is what we want to do, and that's the best way to get this to work, in my opinion. So let's move this, and I'm gonna just rotate this around again. I can now close my layer, put big fire in between them, zoom in, and I think I Control Z'd what I had done before. So let's go back to the render settings. Enable shadows, enable ambient occlusion, and I'm going to do ray traced ambient occlusion, so it's a little bit of a nicer, darker edge. I think that looks a lot nicer. Okay, and then I'm going to move this as well. Let's move this a little bit closer. Okay, so we can start working with this now. I think the next thing that we need to do is reposition our fire. It's a little bit small. It doesn't really match what I showed you earlier. So let's go to a big fire, and I'm actually just going to rename this fire, so I don't have to say big fire 3 every time. And we can just increase the scale. So we can just say, all right, let's do like 150. Then the V key. You have to remember, in Element itself, it's the W key, and then in After Effects, it's the V key. And the reason is, in most 3D software, W is the transform key, but in all of Adobe software, like the V key is how you move something. So let's just pull this up. And this element does have a little bit of depth in it. It does look like there is a little bit of variation, like this is further behind than this part is. So we can use that actually to our advantage later. But what we're going to do is we're going to look at this part and try to get that just behind the letters. So just move that up just a little bit like that. And that looks pretty good. And for now, I'm just going to go back to one view. Back to my main camera. Okay. Right. Okay. So for the next part, let's make some adjustments to the ground. Let's go in and make a nice texture for it, or just choose a preset. So I do have the Pro Shaders Pack. I am going to be using that. You can also make your own. I'm sure there are plenty of tutorials about that. I'm just going to use a Pro Shaders one. Now, you don't have to use these. You can just make your own, okay? And this, the same principles are involved in like doing any type of 3D texturing. So you can watch any type of video on how to make diffuse textures or reflectivity textures or glossy textures or whatever, okay? But I'm just going to use probably a preset here. And not on the actual text, I want to do this on the ground. So I'm going to do, let's just try a few of these. Now you probably have to zoom out since we made our plane so large, and we're probably going to have to repeat the textures on some of these, like this one that's way too big, and if I zoom in it's going to be super blurry. So let me just have a look here. This one, concrete cracked. We'll just use this one. Now, in order to change the UVs, we click on the actual layer itself, the actual object, scroll down to UV mapping, wherever that is, right here in the center, and this will do like 4 and 4, so it's going to repeat it 4 times in each direction. And we don't want to see tiling, but remember, our camera is going to be pretty close up, so we'd rather not have a blurry texture in the foreground. So this will probably be okay. And don't let draft textures put you off, like sometimes this is going to blur your image a little bit, so we can see that is actually a bit sharper. So let's click OK. It's going to change, so that looks all right. And we can do the same thing in the element text. Get this as some kind of metal texture. And again, I'm going to be using the Pro Shaders. Where's metal? I think there's a good one to kind of like galvanized look a little bit. Metal flake, I believe, is what it is called. Metal flake, something like this. That'll work too. Okay, and click OK. So the next thing, let's add some lights. Let's go and add a new light, and this is going to be a point light. And I've already kind of played around with this, so on the intensity here, let's do 100%. I do have cast shadows enabled, and I do increase my shadow diffusion. Otherwise, if you don't increase your shadow diffusion, you're going to get really harsh shadows. So let's do that. And immediately when you add that, it will start affecting your fire background. So let's go to the fire, double click the A key, or just open up all the stack so you can see the entire thing for material options. And we want to turn off accepts lights, and we want to turn off shadows to off. Okay. And then, oops, I want to actually move my light there, my point light. And I'm going to switch back now to two views so I can see both of these. Much easier to see where this light is from the other camera. And I actually want this to be behind from where that fire is. Okay, so kind of centered on around the E and the R, and then just going to pull this up so we get a nice highlight on the ground. And if the colors don't match exactly, don't worry about it. We can change that later. We can just do some simple color correction. Okay, so right, next part. Let's have this background kind of fall off. We want to have it go to kind of fade to black. So in this one, let's go back to one view, back to my main camera. I'm going to actually fit that to 100. So this is under the fog setting. Let's go to the ground layer, scroll down, go to fog. Enable fog, and we want to actually have the fog opacity at 100%. You could also achieve this with a spotlight, but since this ground element is its own layer, we can add a curve to this and make the whole thing darker if we want to, or brighter, depending on what you want to do. The alternative is you have like a spotlight or something pointing down, and then you could have it would only illuminate the kind of a ring of where you wanted it to illuminate. So right now we can see that Inferno is way too bright. So there's multiple things we could do on this one. So on the actual element text, we could go down to our render settings, we could open up physical environment, and we could play around with the lighting influence. So 100% lighting influence will only use the After Effects lights, and 0% influence will only use the IBL lighting, the image-based lighting that's in the environment settings in your scene setup. I kind of like to use both. Let's just do like 50%, so we're going to use half of each. Go to our scene setup, and in your environment, you can change your environment to like something else. And once again, I'm using the pack that came with, I purchased the entire pack for Element 3D and the whole collection of other elements that go with it. But you can find any image online, any HDR, or really these aren't even HDR images, they're just JPEGs. But something with a warm glow would kind of help. And again, you can color correct this by yourself in another application if you want to. And you can even go into your environment tabs, and you do have some settings here for brightness, contrast, saturation. You can change some of those settings. And I'm going to click OK. You can see that it goes a lot darker. And if you wanted to, you could also do the same thing in ground, since we are changing the environment. And this scene is supposed to be in the same area, even though that these are two separate scenes. So this is what's currently being used. That's not really matching. So let's go back to our environment, and then Studio Warm. Now, just makes it a little bit closer to the original. Okay, so for the next part, what we need to get fire reflecting on the sides of these letters. And this is really simple to do. We're just going to go to our element text, and we're going to duplicate that. So if I just solo this for this next part, solo this, and we're actually going to call this like element or text inner edge. And this is going to be a mat. We're going to use this as a luma mat. Go into our scene setup, and we want to create a new bevel. So let's go to bevel 2, or if you have multiple bevels, obviously whatever bevel number you have. And you can only go up to 5 though, so watch out. Okay, so on bevel 2, what we want to do is expand our edges out, expand the edges, and then you may need to just offset the Z, and you may need to even extrude this. We do want this to be the length of our letters. Okay, so the important thing is here is it doesn't matter about the back, but the front, the inner parts of the letters need to be white, and then the other one will just be that matte shadow material that we were talking about earlier. But right now, this is not really going to be appropriate for a luma mat to use, because here it's in shadow, the shadow here is pretty good, it's pretty bright, but we need this to be bright everywhere. So if we scroll down to our illumination settings, if we increase the intensity to 100%, boom, everything is going to be 100% white, and this is what we want. So on our other bevel, the other part of the text, mine's the metal flake, we're going to go to that matte shadow effect, that matte shadow material, and apply that, and then click OK. So when we go back, we can see it's just the edges are going to be white, okay? And depending on the size of your bevel, you might see some wraparound, which is okay. It doesn't really matter. Okay, so for the next part, let's make a copy of our fire. Let's paste that right beneath our inner edge mat. And then we're going to change the track mat to luma. So if we solo this, it's only going to show that fire around the edges of our text. So on our fire text, let's go to Fast Blur. And I know it's legacy now, but I'm going to use Fast Blur until the end. To a value around 20, it just kind of softens out these highlights a little bit. We don't really want it to be very detailed. And if this is not really giving you enough illumination, what we can do, we can click the S key, unlock the scale, and then just increase it on the X. So we can kind of pull that out. And if we soloed this and turned off the luma mat, this looks hideous, but it doesn't matter. We're only looking at the color. And it also flickers, which is nice, so we want that effect as well. So it's beginning to look a little bit more like these letters are actually here, just a little bit.